I guess this was one of the scenes on which we all had the most to do. I mean, I certainly did, because is it the biggest scene in the season? Is it the biggest one?
Financially, yes. Yes. So it's the toughest, biggest, most dramatic, most extras, most money put into it in the show, yeah.
And all done in 2 days?
500-600 extras, all fully dressed, a number of animals.
Oh, God, we had the oxen, didn't we? And just complex, incredibly complex. Yeah. Because not only all the people, but very specific action that you've got the soldiers' action, they've got to do their stuff, you've got Caesar in his chariot, and petals that had to go up in the air, and so wind machines.
I mean, it's not just a big spectacle, it's also a character scene, so we needed to get the big visuals and the small character moments all in 2 days. On a feature, you'd probably spend 2 weeks doing something like this.
It's a military triumph for Julius Caesar. He's won nothing but victories for 8 years, and this is an incredible psychological moment for him and for the Roman people.
Finally, after having conquered in Gaul, crossed the Rubicon, dealt with Pompey, and now he's returning into Rome, and he gets to be a god for a day. The trouble with Caesar, of course, is that he actually believes that he's a god for slightly longer than a day, and that's when it just begins to go awry for him.
Caesar actually had four of them because he was so successful in battle, and this is where the whole of Rome comes to celebrate one of the great generals.
It's got a hugely important dramatic purpose in the series, which is this is the tipping point. Caesar, before this point, is a man. Probably one of the most extraordinarily successful and amazing human beings who's ever lived, but still just a man. But at a certain point, he tips over into being something else. And this is the point, dramatically, that transition happens.
Action, Caesar. Motore. Okay.
And action.
On a show like this, HBO goes to a very short list of directors who can handle something of this scale in the time available. It's a very tricky job because you both have to have the sensibility of a feature director and the speed of a TV director and the bravery of a high wire acrobat or something, because a great deal depends on getting it right the first time. Alan Taylor was chosen because he's both fearless in that way and he's a great director of the small moments of an actor and is able to pull the best out of a huge visual spectacle, which is actually very rare.
And he's coming through the arches. And we cut. Great, one more.
Alan Taylor's just wonderful director, and a lot of great work for HBO, and we wanted to get him on. We thought, given his particular skills and his visual sets, he'd be a great choice for that.
Unlike most scenes, I never storyboard as a director, but on a scene like this, you have to storyboard to give all the departments a chance to be ready for it, and I'm sure the editor will sort of cut it according to the storyboards. But when you shoot this way, you wind up with a lot of material that you didn't expect, so there will be a second cut that really tries to exploit the material that's there.
Relax the actors. Thank you, Bob. We're going to have three cameras on Kieran.
Because of the complexity of the scene, it may only be on the screen for 4 or 5 minutes, but we've broken it over 2 days. We're doing all the very wide shots with the maximum number of extras, the most set dressing to give a sense of the scale of it.
Tomorrow, we will be able to focus more on things like this. You know, what Mark Antony is thinking as Caesar comes in, and what Mark Antony thinks of Atia and Atia, how she feels about him, because that's also part of this big scene. But today it was... There's a child's point of view that carries us into the scene, which is a big defining element of it. It's very much the style of the show that we start very small on the family fighting through the crowd, and only through her point of view do we get access to this big thing.
The director wanted that sense of wonderment for the first view of the forum and the glory of this day to be seen through the eyes of a child. The sheer shock of that and the fantasy of that. So that will be the introduction to the sequence.
A little lower, a little bit of armor.
The head, the glove, eh? The head will be
there a little bit, that's okay.
As you can see the crowd here, you see what, 700 people. Alan's is the director, making faces.
Don't you have some work to do?
Yeah, I have some work to do.
The DP, Alex Sakharov, is always brilliant.
I have three cameras. One of the cameras over there is simulating a girl's point of view through the crowd. As Mr. V, we call him, Mr. Getrix, is being led through. And as the procession happens, as the Caesar enters through the triumphal arch, then the girl is being helped to climb on the pedestal with horses. And then the second camera, which is a crane camera, is going to simulate my point of view from up there. And from there, it's a sweeping shot where it begins down below. And hopefully, if you photograph it right, you'll see it later. And then we follow her from behind and open up the entire square, ask her point of view. In the back there, and photographs just the details. Feet, the armory, the trumpets, the horns, the shields.
Getting reactions from the audience is a huge part of it because it's a big act of theater that Caesar is providing for his subjects. It's a very manipulative gesture he's doing, and we had to watch how it played on the mob, the audience.
We're trying to give a sense of how this would have looked to the average Roman man in the street. Sometimes you get a glimpse of the vastness of a thing, but other times all you see is glimpses of something marvelous but obscured by all the other people who are here.
The language of the show is to be fairly specific about what you're looking at and feel like you're sort of getting behind the scenes into a sort of reality. And if you had too many cameras, it tends to turn into big budget shooting where you just kind of get stuff, and we wanted to make sure it stayed focused.
A triumph is it's many things at the same time. It's like a ticker tape parade for a triumphant general. It's a religious event and it's a social event, and all those things in Roman culture are very much tied together. In a triumph, the general, in this case Caesar, is being elevated to a kind of, for the day, to the level of a demigod.
Yeah, I think that's good? Absolutely bang on, really. Yeah. No, I think that's exactly it, and I think that, you know, it's religious maybe in the sense that you get to be not just as the triumphal general, you get to be not just any old god, you get to be Jupiter, the king of the gods, biggest and best, the Romans called him, and you get to be Jupiter for the day.
That's why he's got that red stuff on his face.
It's painted red because that's Jupiter's votive colour, and you get to wear this outfit that was kept in a special room in the Temple of Jupiter, and so that is who you're being.
This was cool. Yeah, I think more anxiety surrounding the whole thing, given costume department, for example. Oof. And they had all these costumes to make. They were under a lot of pressure.
The ancient Rome was quite colorful. You know, everything was painted. The statues were painted, the temples were painted. It wasn't all white marble.
You know, purple was the royal color. Octavia's wearing purple.
Less was certainly not more, which was 3.5 hours of makeup and hair.
Oh, I see. This is,
you mean the hair should be on this side?
Right, yeah. Atia's wearing red.
The red is really significant because it's associated with Jupiter, and this whole day is about Jupiter.
It's sort of daubed in red.
Mixed with the gold and the red toga should give this idea this is something above humanity. Not quite up there with Jupiter and Juno, but reaching up for it.
Calpurnia is wearing a kind of red-orange, and then Marc Antonio, to make him stand out, I put him in silver and blue, and it really is wow.
Oh, stop posing, James.
This is a very gaudy costume today that I've got on. This is a special triumph costume. This isn't something you normally see Marc Antony in. He's normally quite a plain man, and he's a soldier, but it's like, you know, Sunday best. He's got out and polished off.
I have like a whole army of seamstresses, and even when the girls who are dressing have a few moments, we go back into the wardrobe department and take the veils out and put more details on them. You know, flowers, stripes, anything to make it look like it's not just a flat surface. We want it to have a lot of depth. So it's a big collaboration with all these wonderful artisans that we have here.
It was a gargantuan task, both on a logistical level and on a creative level, because it's none of those clothes are just taken from prop houses or from old Roman shows in the past. They're all rigorously researched by April and Jonathan to be true to this exact period.
Well, God, extras turned up at four. Extras would have turned up at four in the morning for that big day twice. So, yeah, and they, of course, they're exactly right. They all have to be out and ready to go, you know. I can't remember when we actually would have turned over for the first shot, but probably about 11.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, you've got 7 hours of preparation before you can turn over for, the first time.
We have 500 extras, 140 soldiers dressed. Everyone's here. All the citizens are here.
Really, Roman society was phenomenally hierarchical, and everybody knew where they stood in the system. And there's only a few occasions when everybody gets together in one place, from the lowliest slave right the way up to all the representatives of the patrician classes. The big deal about a day like today is that it would all have come together, and that's what's unusual about a triumph.
For us, it was born in Rome, and we like to stay here on the set in the old Rome. Also. So it's very, very fantastic.
We are proud.
Lots and lots of people. We've been here since 4:30 this morning dressing everyone. Oh, we have a big, huge tent that we've set up all the men and all the soldiers. And then we're using our wardrobe department for the women's dressing. And we're finding the men are so much easier than the women. Isn't that amazing?
The job of getting 500 extras in period costume, period haircuts, period makeup. You spend 3 hours just removing people's tattoos. We have just one person just doing that. So it's a vast group of people who are working for the moment the sun comes up until we get through the whole day.
Per ori, pronto? Okay. Facciamo senza carretto, No
part. Probably the ADs have the hardest time. It's the AD's job to sort of look after the elements of the big picture, the background, but today the background is foreground in a way. So they're really shaping the content of the frame a lot.
Who was playing this yesterday?
Every soldier is being spoken to by an American AD, an Italian AD, and a military advisor.
Today we have to march perfect step as the elite Roman army. This is Caesar's legions marching before him. So getting you guys to come in at 4:30 in the morning, dress up as soldiers and be disciplined, is a bit of a challenge.
And I learned very quickly that Italians love mobile phones. They whined for their mobile phones from day one.
We've had some dailies ruined. We found out a lot of the extras as playing soldiers are using their helmets for storage. So they had cigarette packs, they had their cell phones, and the end result is they start marching and the helmets start slipping.
So we've had a rigorous inspection of all of that, and we agreed in a pre-production meeting that we'd keep a good eye on that today.
When you do something like this, you have to bring another 50 soldiers to fill the scene to look like the glorious 13th Legion. I knew I'd put my boot camp guys at the front, wherever the camera was, and then the guys that we only spent a little bit of training with, you put them as the musicians, you know, you put them as the static guards. Some people disregard the fact that they're extras. That scene was undoable without them, so I put them back into the moment that they're wearing the uniform. It's not just about being an extra on a TV show, it's much more than that. This is about having pride, this is about representing your own ancestors.
The Roman Empire was such an important thing for the whole history of the world. You know, they were me. And the guys that work with us are so nice. And I mean, it's awesome.
I think they were fantastic. I looked at the dailies and it looks magnificent.
I think this country, besides being great at, I mean, there's many crafts that Italy is so wonderful in, and actually the extra work is pretty great too, I think, and so they're pretty dependable.
The single memory I have most from the day is that, particularly for the big stuff, which is obviously the most difficult to organise, not only have you got all the problems you can imagine, when you've got extras and you've got different languages and you've got animals and you've got the scale and the scope and the crowd and all the rest of it, but also when you actually, for the biggest shots when we shot, you had these enormous wind machines on to drive all these petals up into the air. So, along with everything else, you couldn't hear a thing.
Better for sound!
There's no point in getting on the walkie-talkie and saying, could you just move so-and-so a little bit over to the right or to the left, because no one's going to be able to hear a thing you're saying. So they had to be super prepared before they shot, and that stuff ultimately comes down to ADs.
Julie Bloom is the main AD, and she's really good at her job.
She'll go again.
Well, yeah.
She moves the extras along, she also moves me along, and she puts a grumpy face on whenever I'm not moving fast enough.
Okay, here we go, please. Thank you.
even with this huge number of extras, we can't dress this top corridor with the right number of people. So we're going to have to replicate those people with visual effects department to give the impression that that entire top corridor is absolutely heaving and packed.
It's the biggest thing we've ever shot over the whole course of this show. And we have more extras, biggest set and set dressing and everything. But it's never big enough, no matter how big you make it. We're able to use real people as a 3D layer in a crowd replication scene, so we can make 300 extras look like 3,000 extras. Once we get up to 50 or 60 different people, and each of them are in different positions, we can pretty much go anywhere you want with that. It's almost like a noise pattern. Once you get beyond a certain distance, we can keep their face the same, but we can make their clothes shift through different colors. I'm here to put things in blue screens and continue off the streets and the buildings and the hills of Rome, and so there's no sort of like enclosed feeling here, that whenever you see off the set, you see real Rome as it was. When I first met Joe Bennett, he showed me around the set and while it was under construction, and I just kept repeating myself, this is so big. And I said, I'm gonna just apologize to you now because people are gonna think that I did this. It's just too big. People don't build sets like this anymore.
The set's incredible.
The set is amazingly accurate. So really all we had to do was just sort of fill it up and shoot it.
It's massive, it's completely realistic. I mean, the most beautiful sets I've ever worked on as an actor.
Joseph Bennett, who's the production designer, in terms of we're using the full width and scale of his set for only the second or third time here in the Forum, and we're seeing virtually all of it by the time we're taking the count of all camera angles.
This is an early sketch that we did for the Triumph that we've just shot, putting Caesar at the back here, using our big Forum as the background, and putting some banners around here. These banners don't really say very much, so we drew up a big banner like this with velvet and big Caesar's eagle in the middle and made a number of those. This is an early sketch for Vercingetorix's cart, which is the killing cart. So we thought that should be ceremonial but vicious.
And now Caesar have the opportunity to show to all Roman people that I'm a loser and is a winner. And today, I will die in Rome.
So then we adapted it. This is version 2 of the cart. Burton gets a bit strapped to the front. In the end, we actually ended up putting him centrally in the cart to make it even more of a something one could view from all around. You know, they wanted to strangle him slowly, so it's not something where he would be killed instantly. You wanted to get the length of torture. The idea that this is kind of dark and gruesome in counterpoint to this really festive Caesar's, you know, the reds and the golds that we use to show he's in power.
The set dressers had a huge task because the Forum is usually just dressed for sort of business as usual, and they had to represent all this, the banners, the garlands, the structures that were built. So sets had to do tons of research and building. The paint was wet when we came in this morning because it was down to the last minute.
Inevitably, it has involved every single department. They would have been going nuts with the incense on a day like this, so we need to smoke up. So I go and talk to Daniel in special effects.
We actually use the same incense that we did research on that the Vatican uses for the Pope. And we have a lot to do with recreating the atmosphere of Rome, basically, of how it was, because historically it was much different from what they actually say it was, because it was a very dirty and wet and damp because of the aqueducts. So there was a lot of activity going on between fires and smoke and leaking pipes.
Stunts are obviously involved because we got people up in high places who are dealing with all the petals being an essential part of the whole religious ritual. So
we're using our big fans all around this big square, and we're blowing them into the air, thousands and thousands of bags of petals. And obviously, the second we started doing it, the wind picked up, and so we're kind of battling the wind, but it's actually worked out great.
I spoke to Arthur Wicks, and we had a joke about what his budget was for rose petals for the scene, and he wouldn't tell me. I kept pressing him on it. I said, look, come on, just tell me. Tell me how much you're spending on rose petals, and he wouldn't. So it must have been a lot.
You're going to get so many people writing up and phoning up and complaining that's not right, that's not right. And I don't try not to give them the opportunity to have a go at me about it.
You're taking the, you know, this great force against which you've been in conflict for hundreds of years, and you are sacrificing literally the man who represents them, their symbol. If you read accounts of public executions in Britain in the 16th and the 17th century, it's very raucous and loud and drunken up to the moment of truth. But the moment of truth, when the person is actually dispatched and executed, is very often accompanied with, it's kind of like a religious, reverential thing at which prayers mm-hmm. were said, and people in the crowd crossed themselves.
The sense in which you gain strength by taking your enemy's life is probably a universal feeling amongst, certainly amongst more primitive people to a degree. And, you know, even today, there's still elaborate rituals around surrenders in which you humiliate the opposition in a ritual way. But to a degree, everyone understands that, you know, in their soul, if you defeat someone, somehow whatever strength they had
comes into you.
The sacrifice they make is Vercingetorix, who is the chieftain of the Gauls, who very nearly brought Caesar to his knees and is a hugely respected foe. And they basically torture him in front of everybody.
There was a great deal of respect for the Gauls as the kind of, they were the traditional enemy of the Romans, and they were considered a brave, strong, great people. And by killing Vercingetorix in that public ritual way, the Romans were, and Caesar in particular, were kind of taking his power for themselves. They didn't have any xenophobia or prejudice against other cultures. On the contrary, they took it in and absorbed them.
The ritual execution of his great enemy, it's as if the life passing out of the enemy passes into Caesar to give him new life and passes into the whole of the Roman people. Where they're witnessing that as a religious act, not necessarily a sadistic act, and it's about sort of spiritual transfer.
Caesar at this moment seems to proclaiming himself not quite as a god, but wanting to be one of God's representatives on earth.
I'm tending to shoot him as a kind of icon more than I ordinarily would, because here today he's turning himself self-consciously into an icon and a demigod. So frequently he's very big in the foreground of our frame, frequently shot from behind with the crowd that he's playing to, and we sort of sparingly get access to an intimate close-up.
A huge amount of psychological conflict in this crowd looking at him. And as Bruno says in his camera notes for the episode 10, the symbolism is obvious to everyone. There's just one ruler in Rome now.
There's lots of unhappy accidents, but happy accidents. This is another reason Alan Taylor is such a great director, is because only good directors can identify and grab those happy accidents. There's a moment where a big red banner comes down from the roof. It's a very beautiful, slightly surreal shot. And Alan just saw them dressing the set and saw this rather beautiful gliding motion that you get if you were right underneath it, and shot it. So the director always needs to be open to those kind of things and be aware of them when they happen. Which is a very difficult thing to do, because most people would just be gripped by the fear of, you know, what they're supposed to shoot, leave alone stuff that isn't
you
even
might
on
just
the,
get. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.